Welcome to Smart Catalyst, November 27, 2018. So today we are going to see all these prelims article. The first one is EU-India in joint bid to fill the vacancies at the WTO body. The second article is government makes fresh attempt at the direct tax code. The third article is about the hybrid car subsidy by government. And the fourth article is RBI eases the ECB hedging norms for companies. And the fifth one is PIL, which urges Minimum Wages Act for domestic workers. And the seventh one is Dam Safety Bill 2018. And only 40% of RCEP items finalized. And the last article is RBI can transfer 1 trillion of its excess reserves to the government, the recent report. So the first article is EU and India in a joint bid to fill the vacancies at the WTO body. So what the news here is, India recently co-sponsored a joint initiative which is launched by the European Union for the purpose of filling vacancies at highest adjudicating body for disputes at the WTO, despite of the repeated attempts by the US for blocking the selection process. So what the content here is, actually the WTO, which is the World Trade Organization, it has one dispute resolution solving body, which is the highest adjudicating body, and that is known as DSB, okay? So which is dispute settlement body, and it has two subdivisions. One is the appellate body and another one is the panel. So this, in this appellate body, it has actually 7 members. But as of now, it is having like only 3 members. Okay, so there are 4 vacancies. So the all other countries combinedly want to fill these 4 vacancies, but US has all along actually objected this selection process or filling of these vacancies. So why US is opposing? In the sense, US is recently putting lot of tariffs on steel, aluminium and major products which are imported from other countries. So in order to enjoy that tariff benefits by the US continuously, it wants these vacancies to be left unfilled, okay? So if suppose these are getting filled, then it is going to affect the US because it is against the WTO norm. WTO actually want to establish a free and fair global trading system. So it should be open. There should be no tariffs and all between all these countries. But it is against the WTO norm, right? So that is why US is preventing or single-handedly blocked this proposal of filling these 4 vacancies, okay? And what the major concern here is, in 2019, the 3 members are further reduced to a single member when the 2 more members who are now there are going to end their second term or going to retire. So to resolve this issue, India along with other countries, these countries, okay? So has released a joint proposal on November 26, which states the successful contribution of the appellate body of the DSB for the security as well as the prediction of the multilateral trading system in the global level, okay? So now we are going to see what is the role of this appellate body in the dispute settlement body, okay? So before that, we have to know about the WTO's role in this context. The WTO is having this DSB, right? So the power to settle the trade disputes is what the difference between the WTO and the previously existed GATT. Okay, so the GATT was replaced by WTO, and the major difference between these two is the power of the trade dispute settlement mechanism. So it has more power and has more stress on the trade dispute resolution mechanism by means of this dispute settlement body. So if any member countries of this DSB or the WTO, say China or India or any other member, if they files a complaint against any other country for their trade practices or for their tariffs and all, then this complaint is directed to this DSB, and it is, this matter is resolved by this dispute settlement body. So from this, we can clearly understand that this DSB has the power to penalize the offending country, and this clearly indicates that the DSB is the backbone of the global trading system of which is under WTO. So in order to preserve this, in order to retain the power of this appellate body, in order to preserve the rights and obligations of these members, there are certain proposals which is put forward by these 12 countries, including India. And one is, we have to address this issue whilst or while among we are considering the US concern also. That means we have to address by considering the US concerns. thereby we can improve the dispute settlement understanding in a clearer way. So the second proposal is transitional rule for outgoing appellate body member. That means now there are three members in the appellate body, right? So if any member is going to retire, that outgoing member shall complete the disposition of pending appeal. That means you have to finish the pending cases in which hearing has already been taken place during the member's time period itself. So finish the pending case and then go. This is also a proposal which is put forward in that appellate body filling vacancies. Okay. And the third major proposal is the 90-day rule in Article 17.5 of the DSU should also be more enhanced and transparent. Okay. So these are all the proposals by the India as well as other 11 countries. So the next article is government makes fresh attempt at direct tax code. So what the news here is, now the government is trying to modernize the Income Tax Act 1961, and for that the center appointed a committee under Akhilesh Ranjan, who is a member of Central Board of Direct Taxes, and he is the head of this task force. Okay, so this task force is going to make some changes and try to modernize this Income Tax Act 1961, and also they are going to advise the government on drafting the new direct tax law that suits for the current Indian economy trend. Okay, so now we are going to see the government initiative. So during the recent years, the government has actually been trying to make this direct tax collection more efficient, and they are also having given a lot of benefits to the corporates as well as to the smaller businesses by means of giving corporate tax concessions for the corporate entities and reduce the corporate tax rates for smaller businesses to 25%, thereby trying to bring them into the formal sector and also trying to increase the tax base of our economy. And the third one is, the major initiative is giving relief to small income earners by lowering the tax rates. That means the small income earners don't need to pay the taxes. Okay, they are getting relieved from the tax payment itself. And the fourth major initiative is, the government actually plugged the loopholes which is in the bilateral tax treaties with Mauritius. Because of the loopholes, lot of business entities actually evade the tax payment and all, and they try to bring the money which it sent to Mauritius back in the form of FDI. So it is known as round tripping, right? So in order to curb that and in order to make the tax evasion as illegal, the government is actually trying to modify this Income Tax Act 1961. So these are all the previous initiative by the government, but this new amendment of the Income Tax Act, what it will do in the sense, it is expected to make taxation more progressive, which means the richer person has to pay more taxes. Okay, so it is what the progressive means. So that means the tax burden will be higher on those people who are having better payment capacity. If you are richer, you pay more tax. If you are not that much richer, then you pay lesser tax. Okay. So it is clearly visible by means of this recent GST implementation, where it is having tax slabs, right? So 8%, 21%, something. In that, if you see, the luxury items are subjected to the highest tax rate of 28%, which the only rich can afford, and the mass use items are either exempted from the GST or kept in a very lower tax slab of 5%. Okay, so what the final conclusion here is, as direct tax is a complex one, the government, instead of seeking for bringing out new law, it can also seek for amending the existing law in a better way also. So the third article is hybrid car subsidy in India. So what the news here is, recently the Department of Heavy Industries asked the Expenditure Finance Committee, EFC, for a subsidy of 13 crore to promote hybrid cars. So for promoting this, they ask for a subsidy. So what is the background here means, the government recently decided to place the hybrid cars under the highest GST slab of 28% plus 15% cess tax also on the hybrid items, but the electric cars were put in the 12% slab. So it clearly shows the government intention to promote only the electrical vehicles and not the hybrid vehicles. And on realizing this, the Toyota actually withdrew its hybrid cars from the Indian market as a whole. So it makes the government to realize that. So as this Toyota withdrew, the government is now trying to give subsidy for promoting the hybrid cars. Okay. So if they promote the hybrid cars, or if they give subsidy to the hybrid cars, then it will bring a solution for the problems of oil imports as well as the rising pollution in our country. So if you see in this picture, it is normal fuel consumption vehicle and it is hybrid vehicle. So in this, if it takes 100% of fuel means, then it takes like only 60%, okay? So it is by means of 40% reduction of the fuel as well as the pollution as a whole, okay? So by means of adopting this hybrid vehicle, we can achieve improved fuel efficiency. So if you see here, the government has also brought the FAME scheme for faster adoption and manufacturing of electric as well as the hybrid vehicles in India. So as per this FAME scheme, these are the targets. One is this much, that means 6 to 7 million hybrid and electric vehicles should be sold by 2020, and 9,500 million liters of fuel should be saved, and 2 million tons of reduction in pollution as well as the greenhouse gases. And by means of doing all these things, nearly 65,000 direct and 3 lakh indirect jobs are created. So these are the aims or the objectives of this FAME scheme. So it is recently brought by the government. And in one meeting, the PM has also spoken about the hybrid car's importance by means of stating that there is the CNG, which is the compressed natural gas vehicle, and then the methanol based vehicle, and the third alternative or the best alternative is the hybrid car. So it insists how much important it is, right? And these hybrid vehicles have matured as well as cleaner fuel than the vehicles which is having internal combustion engines, which uses the fossil fuels or the coal based fuels. So overall, the focus of the government should be on the green mobility. That is what this article suggests. The next article is RBI eases the ECB hedging norms for companies. So what this article talks about is, recently RBI eases the ECB hedging norms, thereby it reduces the mandatory hedge coverage of any company from 100% to 70% and other ECB framework. So we have to know what this hedge coverage means, and we have to know what is this ECB means. So hedge coverage means it is a risk management mechanism. Okay. That means it is a risk avoidance mechanism for any individual or a company under any crisis situation. In order to handle the crisis situation of the running of the entity itself, then this hedge is acting as a risk management mechanism. So it is like saving certain amount of money as a capital buffer in your company and spending the remaining money alone, okay? So hedges, like hedging certain amount of money separately, okay, to tackle the crisis situation. Okay. So by means of relaxing this, it will actually lower the cost of hedging, okay? So now we are going to see what is this external commercial borrowing. So any money which is borrowed by an individual or an entity in India from foreign sources for financing the commercial activities in our country. So that money which is borrowed is called ECBs, which are the external commercial borrowings. So the Department of Economic Affairs, which is under the Ministry of Finance, is responsible for the monitoring as well as the regulation of the external commercial borrowing guidelines and policies. Okay, so note this. So now we are going to see the track one under ECB framework, and it refers to the medium term foreign currency denominated ECBs with an average maturity of 3 to 5 years. So that is why it is medium term, right? 3 to 5 years. Okay. So what the prime purpose for RBI to relax these ECB norms, in the sense it is to increase the liquidity, especially for the benefit of NBFCs. Okay. So by means of this relaxation, NBFCs can get more benefited by means of fueling or capitalization into NBFCs. So the next article is PAL, which urges Minimum Wages Act for domestic workers. So what the news here is, recently a petition has been filed in the Supreme Court for seeking its intervention to bring dignity to the informal sector people, who are especially the domestic workers. That means the domestic workers should be come under the ambit of this Minimum Wages Act of 1948. They should be recognized under this Minimum Wages Act. That is what this petition actually aimed at. So why the domestic workers, in the sense, because after the liberalization, the Indian homes have actually witnessed an increase of 120% domestic workers. Okay, so in order to make these 120% increase of the domestic workers accessible to the social security benefits of the government, this petition actually sought to recognize them under this Minimum Wages Act. And they also have stressed on the fact that the work hours for these domestic workers should be reduced to 8 hours per day, and they should also be given with the mandatory weekly off, which is a basic right under the Article 21 of our Indian Constitution. But if you see, we already have this minimum wages act for the organized sector people. So now they are trying to bring it for the unorganized, and in that especially for the domestic workers. Okay. So if we bring them under this, then they can enjoy the social security benefits, as well as there is no exploitation, and we can easily empower the people. Okay. So the next article is Dam Safety Bill 2018. So the Ministry of Water Resources, River Development and Ganga Regeneration has recently drafted this Dam Safety Bill 2018 in order to ensure the institutional setups in both central as well as the state level for improving the dam safety practices all across the country. Okay. So if you see in this picture, it actually aims to constitute NCDS, which means National Committee on Dam Safety, for making the policies. And it also want to establish the National Dam Safety Authority, NDSA, in order to implement those policies. And it also aimed to constitute the State Committee on Dam Safety by each and every respective states in order to ensure the implementation of the policy guidelines by these NCDS. So it is the apex kind of apex institution, and these are like the sub institutions. Okay. So this will address the issues which is regarding the dam safety, like regular inspection of dam, emergency action plan, dam safety review and instrumentation and safety manual, etc. And in addition to all these, this bill is actually also provide an emergency action plan to combat any kind of disaster which is arising out of dam failures by means of involving technological solutions like flood warning system, then early warning system, then regular checkups, etc. Okay. However, though it looks like a good move, certain states like Tamil Nadu and all are actually opposing the institution or constitution of this NCDS, stating that this kind of central body for dam regulation is affecting the federal characteristic of our country because it is not taking the consensus of states' decision into account. So if it is involving the state's consensus also, then only it is federal. But if it is not, then it is affecting the federal characteristic. Okay. So this is what certain states are stating for this bill. Okay. So the next article is only 40% of RCEP items finalized. So what the news here is, recently the RCEP meeting had been held at the Singapore on November 12 and 13. But though the expectations are much higher, but it is not going as it was expected, because only the 40% of the RCEP items having been resolved and remaining 60% of items or RCEP items are yet to be resolved. Okay. That means they actually deferred the remaining things or remaining items to next year. And also the core talk related with the goods and services market access, as well as the investment among the RCEP countries, is also still going on. So now we are going to see what this RCEP means. It is Regional Comprehensive Economic Partnership. It actually has 10 Asian countries, as well as India, China, Japan, South Korea, Australia, as well as New Zealand. Okay. So ASEAN plus 6 countries. So ASEAN is having like 10 countries, right? And one more concern which was raised during this RCEP meet is a key issue for the usage of the terminology, which is substantial conclusion. That means each and every country's economy is still in the progressing stage. So the term of using this conclusion is not suitable for every economy which is taking part in this Regional Comprehensive Economic Partnership. So India actually opposed the usage of this terminology, pointing out that this phrase is a legal term in many countries. So instead of using the conclusion term, you can make use of the word substantial progress, which suits more for the developing countries. So the last prelims article is RBI can transfer 1 trillion of its excess reserves to the government. So what the news here is, the government is actually asking for the RBI's excess reserves in order to meet its fiscal deficit. Okay. But the RBI is not willing to give the reserve to the government. So in order to handle this situation or in order to deal with this case, a committee was actually constituted solely for this purpose, okay? So that committee is actually looking into this matter and it comes to a conclusion that RBI is actually having more than adequate reserves, okay? So it can transfer nearly 1 trillion of its excess reserve to the government, okay? So it stated like nearly 1 to 3 trillion, which is of 0.5 to 1.6% of the GDP of a country as excess capital with the RBI. So it can transfer it to the government. This is what the newly constituted committee stated, okay? So by means of amending the section 47 of RBI Act 1934, it actually enables the RBI to transfer its excess surplus to the government, okay? So one more thing you have to note here is about the capping of the contingency reserve. So the contingency reserve, if it is capped at 3.5%, then RBI can transfer a 1.05 trillion to government, okay? So it all depends on the capping. So that is what fixed by the newly constituted committee now. And if you see here, the overall reserve, it is about contingency reserve, it is overall reserve. So if it is a 20%, as against 28.3% as of now. Now we are having this much. But if it is 20%, then it will be able to release 3 trillion to the government as excess reserve. Okay. So it is recommended by USA Thoret panel. So now we are going to see all these mains article. The first one is the sociology of air pollution. The second one is the world can change China. The last article is unease of doing business in Delhi. Okay. So the first article is the sociology of air pollution. So recently the air pollution is increasing tremendously, not only in urban centers or urban cities, but also all across the country. So how to handle those air pollution or how to deal with or how to fight against this air pollution? So that is what this article talks about. Okay. So it started like this: driving a little less, recycling waste and pushing the renewable energy more will not appreciably lessen the impact. That means whatever we previously supposed to lessen or reduce the air pollution is not doing that much good. That is what the reality is. So that is how the author starts this article. So it also states like nearly 2/3 of the energy usage and the emissions of the carbon dioxide comes only from the cities, and in the nearly two-thirds of the pollution comes only from the vehicles. Okay. That means that much bad the transportation system is in our country, and it only results in the poor air quality all around the country. And not only that transportation, but also the types of building that we have and the type of dietary that our citizens are having, each and everything is contributing its part to the pollution. But despite of finding the root cause of these problem, we are just dealing with only the external symptoms. That is what the author raised the concern here. So we have to take Beijing, that is the China's success, as an example in order to combat this air pollution, because China's efficient public transport system covers nearly 70% of the trips. So public transportation system itself is 70%, okay? So we have to also follow the same line. That is what he suggested. And if you see in our country especially, the middle class is the cause for the problem and they are the victims, as well as they only have the solution in order to combat this climate change as well as the urban air quality. So if this trend continues, that is if this climate change is going to continue, it is also putting stress on the social transformation of our society as a whole itself. So this indicates the intensity of the air pollution and its effects on the global level as well as in the local level, right? So now we are going to see what are the three major policy questions which occurs due to global as well as the local level. That is, much of the air pollution which are caused by activities that led to the climate change. For example, burning of the fossil fuels, vehicular emissions, as well as the industrial activities. So these activities are all actually triggering the climate change by means of inducing more air pollution, right? So what we have to do, we have to make comprehensive plans and policies in city-wise as well as state-wise as well as country-wise. So comprehensive policies are needed in order to combat this air pollution. So the second major question is the West, which is having only 1/5 of the population, is actually making utilize of 4/5 of the natural resources. Okay, so it is a major concern, right? That is, a smaller number of people are making use of larger number of resources. So what we have to do here means we have to plan as well as modify the usage of the natural resources in a better and efficient way. So that is the way forward. We have to bring out some kind of reforms in the usage of the natural resources, both by the developed as well as the developing nations. So proper plan should be there. Okay, so that is also mentioned here. And the third major question is the codes, with their reliance on simply the regulation and bans, will not change the behavior. So everything should be started from the individual itself. The behavior itself should be changed, not merely the regulations and the bans which is promoted or which is put forward by the courts. So for that, we have to change the behavior of the individual. That is, the value matters first. So that is the first way forward. And the second one is the well-being and the resource use. That means the infrastructure, which is more important than the industry. So the proper planning should be there for the infrastructure in order to adopt for the long-term trends. Okay, so that is also put forward by the author. So now, if you see in this picture, nearly 7 million people die prematurely every year only because of this air pollution, either it is household air pollution or outdoor air pollution. So by means of understanding this intensity itself, we have to change the behavior. So what they are stating here is, now the countries are actually transforming or changing into the largest source of polluters. So the countries are the largest source of pollution. The behavior of the countries are changing. For example, urban energy and usage is the major source of the pollution. So what we have to do, the urban design of infrastructure should be taken into account while framing the policies. So if you see the buildings in the cities, it nearly accounts for 1/3 of the consumption and 1/5 of the emission. And it is predicted to be get doubled by 2050. So this is also taken into consideration, right? So it is a major concern. And so from all these, it is clearly visible that the transportation system in our country is the fastest growing and it is the largest source of the pollution. So any policies or any framework that is going to be get implemented should be focused on changing the behavior of the transportation system in our country. So that is what stressed in this article. Okay. So if you see, there is a focus on mobility instead of transport. So how the people are mobilizing from one place to another place, that pattern should first get to be changed. So this mobility should be the core concern of the smart cities project itself, or it should focus on that. And nearly 80% of the people who are living in the city would prefer to take public transport if it is affordable, robust, and last mile connectivity is available. But if it is not, then they go for separate vehicles, right? So we have to take this also into account. And nearly 6 out of the 10 non-users of the public transport are willing to shift to the public transportation system if it is provided safety, coverage, as well as the frequency. That means, for example, metro or electric train. If these kind of modern things or safety things are provided, as well as more frequency is provided, then obviously a lot of people is going to choose this over the separate vehicles, right? So the priority should be redesigned for making the public and shared transport more viable as well as affordable. So that is what stated. Okay, so the next article is the world can change China. So this article talks about how the external factors are actually influencing China and how it actually changing the China from the closed economy to an open economy, and again now it is overturning into a closed economy. Okay, so the first major external pressure is the agitation by the Christian missionaries. That is, the Chinese women actually had the habit of practice of food binding during the 19th century, but in order to liberate the women from the practice of that food binding, there were a lot of agitations by the Christian missionaries in China, and it put an end to such kind of practice in the last imperial dynasty during 19th century. So it is the first pressure in China's policies by external factors, which is the Christian missionaries, especially the Western countries. Okay. And second major external pressure is the foreign experts help to modernize the custom service or the import-export services of the China. This is also helping the China to open up a little bit from its closed system to open system, right? So the third major external pressure is 1989 Tiananmen Square massacre, which actually triggered a lot of business people to flood out from China. So it actually triggered a lot of people to get away from Chinese market. So because of this incident, US had put sanctions on China after that 1989 incident. So in order to tackle the US sanction and in order to tackle the Western pressure as well as to emulate the Western success, the China had actually taken certain kind of pro-market reforms. So it is also a kind of changing attitude of China from its closed system to an open system by means of US pressure. So it is one of the external pressure which was faced by China, right? So the next big step for its open economy is the liberalization of Chinese market by means of entrance of Chinese into the WTO in 2001, which actually aims to increase the fair global trading practices, right? So this next one is the US pressure indirectly made the China to lift the cap on the foreign investment, thereby it attracts more foreign investors into the Chinese economy. So these are all indicate how the China is actually changing over a period of time from the closed as well as the communist country into an open and liberal country. But this recent policies of Xi's is actually reversing the situation as a whole. That is, again, it is going back from the open market to a closed market, and this actually triggers the retrograde policies of Xi's actually trigger the middle class people in the Chinese market to overseas. They are actually going out of the country, and similarly the private businesses in China is also having no faith in the future by holding the investment in Chinese market. And also the policies of Xi is again showing that the Mao era politics is reviving back in the Chinese country, and it triggers ultra rich people the fear of expropriation. So how they are concluding here is the US imposition of tariffs on the Chinese market is actually the prime purpose is to show that the Chinese mercantilism, that is, it is only to exhibit the Chinese mercantilism as well as the closedness of the Chinese market, and not it is nothing to do with the Chinese export, and it is not going to affect the Chinese exports in any way. So that is not the actual intention. But without understanding this trend, the Xi's recent policies, which is actually moving towards the closed economy, is again reassuring the or well grounding the Chinese mercantilism, right? So these kind of trade tariffs imposition over one another by means of this trade war, after a certain period of time, it will turn into a cold war. And it threatened the relationship of China with its friend countries as well as its allies. And in the long run, it reduced the impact of US action and it increases the distance among the friendship nation of the China, right? These are the latent aim of US imposition of tariffs. So good relationship with US are still important, but concerted international effort to change the problematic Chinese economic behavior is the need of the hour. So that is what proposed in this article about the Chinese economy's evolution over a period of time and its way back. So the last article is unease of doing business in Delhi. So what the news here is, though India has seen dramatic rise in the World Bank doing business ranking, that is from 100 to 77, right? So the actual reality is that the small enterprises are still struggling in the face of license permit inspector Raj, which is indicating the tough as well as the regulatory, thoughtless regulatory framework of the government. So what this article talks about is the thoughtless regulatory framework which is prevailing in India's second largest commercial city, which is Delhi. Okay, so it is not that much easy to do business in Delhi, especially by the traditional retail service enterprises. So they are saying it by stating that the Indian food sector markets, which nearly contributed 2.1% of GDP, though it contribute this much, nearly 66% of the food sectors are still unorganized. So they can't enjoy the benefit of the government, right? And it is like nearly, it takes 120 to 150 days to obtain the licenses, even if there is no delay in the process of acquiring the licenses, and they have to pay more to acquire the licenses. So the overall licensing procedure is very difficult, and the government is also having this kind of thoughtless regulatory framework and the government monopoly, which means these kind of stringent regulatory framework for the food sector markets and the need to acquire more licenses, the need to submit more documents before they open the shop legally in our country. So it is very tough, right? And it also faces cumbersome and offer overlapping regulations. This process, this whole process is very daunting in the absence of clear procedural clarity and functional common channels between government and enterprises. There should be a clear way or channel between the government and the enterprises so that they can obtain this license, permit, everything in a very quicker way. Okay, so they are stating like not only this licensing process but the sudden arbitrary change in rules by the government, arbitrary rules change, okay, as well as frequent and unreasoned government orders. These are all also impacting adversely the operations of the small enterprises. For example, the Department of Excise in Delhi recently banned the liquor serving restaurant from playing the music because of the nuisance by high volume. So these are all need to be considered, right? And not only that food sector, but also the livestock sector, which contribute nearly 4.1% of GDP. They are also having a lot of violation of the doctrine of separation of power. And they mainly aim to ban the private slaughter. So that is government monopoly in the sense they only want government to do this livestock sector and they want to ban the private slaughter. And 95% of the enterprises in this livestock sector remains either completely or partially unlicensed. So these are again a major concern. So the third major concern is the inspection regime. So the corruption, harassment and the subversion of rules during the inspection by the inspectors. So that is also actually adversely impacting the service sector as a whole. And the last major concern is the businessman, apart from paying money for obtaining licenses, they have to undergo this kind of arbitrary inspections and the rules changes by the government then and there. So it also less incentivize or deter the entrepreneurs from growing their business, right? So what is the way forward here is, if this is the state of affairs in Delhi, then we can easily imagine the difficulties of doing business for small entrepreneurs in the rest of our country, right? So what is the way out of it is to rethink and redraw the licensing as well as the inspections rule, particularly at the intersection of local, state as well as the central government level. And we have to realize the true aim of the ease of doing business. That is, the economic freedom of the individual is very much higher and important, and it is not negotiable. So it is very important for the human beings to flourish. So instead of only making opportunities and making life easier for the larger businesses, the government should also take some steps to improve the flexible policies for smaller enterprises also. Thank you.